بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد سيد الأولين والآخرين وعلى جميع إخوانه من النبيين والمرسلين وآل كل وصحب كل ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما يا رب العالمين. All praise is due to Allah, and may Allah raise the rank of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and protect his nation from that which he fears for them. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to increase our knowledge and benefit us with the knowledge we have acquired. Ameen. We'll continue explaining the obligatory knowledge, and we started a few chapters about the sins of different body parts. We finished talking about the sins of the tongue, and we'll start talking about the sins of the ear. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, إِنَّ السَّمْعَ وَالْبَصَرَ وَالْفُؤَادِ كل أولئك كان عنه مسؤولا. Your hearing, your sight, your heart, you'll be questioned about all of them on the day of judgment. How did you use your ears? Did you listen to what is forbidden, or you listened only to what is beneficial for you? You are going to be questioned about your eyes. How did you use them? Did you look at what is forbidden, or you looked at what is accepted only? And so on. All your body parts will be questioned about them. Even at a stage on the day for judgment, Allah Azza wa Jal will make everyone silent, unable to talk. Then Allah Azza wa Jal orders the limbs to talk, and one's hands and legs will talk, and they testify for the person or against him. So let every one of us observe his body organs closely and make sure he uses them only in what is accepted in Islam. Amongst the sins of the ear is to listen to the private conversation which others meant to hide. So that's a sin for one to listen without an excuse to the conversation of other people while knowing that they want to hide it from such a person. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith, the one who listens to a conversation of people while they hate that they are listened to, so they don't like this person to listen to their conversation, on the day for judgment, molten lead, you know, the lead, molten lead will be poured in his ears. Because this is classified as a kind of forbidden spying. Also amongst the sins of the ear is to listen to the flute, lute, and other forbidden musical instruments. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in another hadith that two sounds are cursed in this life and in the hereafter. The sound of the flute, when people are having a kind of enjoyment, and the sound of lamenting and wailing, which we explained before, upon the death of one. Music is a sign of the enormous sinners. That's the sign. You know, the enormous sinners would have such a forbidden music to be encouraged to commit fornication, adultery, drinking alcohol and the like. That's why because it is an indication of their acts, the Muslim is not allowed to listen to that forbidden music. Look at the difference between the one who listens to Quran and praises, for instance, chantings, praising Allah, praising the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His heart will soften, will become more motivated to perform acts of worship. However, the one who listens to the forbidden music, most of the songs that they write these days, the lyrics for them, they encourage one to do the haram. So we'll take one away from religion. Also amongst the sins of the E is to listen to gossip, ghiba, about a Muslim that one hates to be mentioned with. To listen to tale-bearing, namima. And namima is to transmit words from one person to another for the purpose of stirring up troubles between them, to cause enmity between them. All these are from the sins of the E, to listen to that. So if you are in a session and they start gossiping someone, although you are not gossiping, you are not talking about that person, but you are not allowed to listen to that forbidden gossip or participate in their talk in a way. So if you are approached by someone who might say to you, have you heard what that person so and so did? Here you do not encourage him by saying, what happened, what did he do? No, rather you say, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us, min husni islami al-mar' tarkuhu ma la ya'ni. A sign that a person is practicing his religion properly is that he does not get involved in what does not concern him. So say to him, this matter does not concern me. So I don't want to listen to that person, why he divorced his wife and what happened with his wife and so on. This matter does not concern me. Also, one needs to change the subject if able. If he can change the subject, that would be great. Just to steer him away from gossiping others. So use a kind of technique to change the topic, change the subject. So you might get them engaged in another talk, so you can steer him away from talking about people in this way. If they don't listen, so despite you mention to them, fear Allah, don't talk about others, that will not benefit you, then they didn't listen, then you leave that session. It was also mentioned that gossiping, tale-bearing, and not protecting oneself from being contaminated with urine are the most reasons for one's torture in the grave. It's not worth it to keep listening. You participate in the gossip and you put yourself in a danger of being tortured in the grave. It's not worth it. So that's why think about the consequences that will give you strength to defy what's happening if it's haram. So you tell them, don't do this, that's haram, that's forbidden. If they are committing a sin, tell them, don't be afraid or shy, don't feel embarrassed, because they did not feel embarrassed committing the haram in your presence. Why do you want to feel embarrassed to tell them this is haram, don't do it? It really saddens me when someone tells me, I was in a session and they started talking 1, 2, 3. Then in the end, I ask him, what did you do? He might say, nothing. I was worried they might not accept, whatever, all these excuses. Why didn't you tell them? You are worried about their emotions and they did not care about your emotions when they committed the haram in your presence. We move on now to talk about the sins of the hands. Amongst the sins of the hands is to give short, that's cheating. when measuring by volume, weight, or arm length. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَيْلٌ لِلْمُطَفِّفِينَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا اكْتَالُوا عَلَى النَّاسِ يَسْتَوْفُونَ وَإِذَا كَالُوهُمْ أَوْ وَزَنُوهُمْ يُخْسِرُونَ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala threatened those people with a severe torture on the day of judgment. Those when selling and buying, they cheat. So if they are selling, they try to lessen the amount, whether it is by weight, volume, or arm length. In the past, they used to sell fabric using the arm length. So they say that's one, that's two, that's three. So if they want to sell them, they stretch it to the max to say this is one. And then when they release it, it will be half maybe. That's cheating. When they are buying, they make sure it's very loose. So it's one and something. So those who cheat, they make sure when they are buying of someone, they take the right in full and in addition as well. But when they sell, they give short. Allah threatened them with a severe torture in the hereafter. Also to steal, that's a major sin as well, which is to take unrightfully the belongings of others stealthily from the place where usually such items are kept. Where would people keep the jewelry, for instance? If you have jewelry at home, you put them in a safe or in a cupboard with lock and the like. That's where you keep them usually. So that's the place where such items are kept usually. So if someone were to, let us say, go into your house and take the jewelry from that place, that is classified Islamically as stealing. If he finds the jewelry, for instance, in the front yard, it fell off you, it's in the front yard, and he picked it up and ran away, that's haram, that's a major sin. But it's not defined as stealing. Stealing is to take the item from where it is kept usually, for safekeeping. Where you keep him usually, to take it from there, that is classified as stealing. Furniture, for instance, you're not gonna put furniture in the cupboard. Where you keep the furniture is different from the place where you keep the jewelry. So when you take an item from where it is kept usually, that is defined Islamically as stealing. If you find something on the road and you pick it up and you take it and you spend it, that's haram. Because Islamically, the lost and found item, you have to announce this item to people for 1 year. You might put a sign and you might call out for people, whoever lost an item, let him come to me, whatever. So you need to keep identifying and announcing this matter for 1 year before you can use it. If you want to keep it after that, the scholar said, with the intention that even after 1 year, if the owner shows up, you tell him, I used what I found, I can give you the money, let us say, alternative, or you forgive me, for instance. So you need to be ready to reimburse the owner when he shows up after that. Also amongst the sins of the hands, to loot, meaning to unrightfully take the belongings of others openly, as you see in some parts of the world, whenever they start a protest, they start looting. That's haram. So they are taking the items openly. This is called looting. And that is haram. That's a major sin as well. To take the money of others unjustly in any way is forbidden. What is called April Fool's Day, as you know, in many cases they terrorize people. They give them false news about their relatives and the like, to the extent that those people might have a heart attack upon receiving such bad news. So to terrorize them, even in such matters, that is forbidden as well. And do not say, "I was joking." You might kill that person with your joke. So that's not a good habit. Also amongst the sins of the hands is to take and give a bribe. Islamically, subhanAllah, so even when you hear about these matters, you say, subhanAllah, yeah, it makes sense. Like you want to achieve something, so you bribe that person. Someone might bribe the judge to make him change the rule. Let us say there is a dispute between two people about a land. Someone wronged the other one by taking part of his land. He changed the borders of his land. He took part of the other person's land. And now it's time for the judge to decide. Then someone might give that judge money and say to him, "I want you to give me this land," which does not belong to him. So this is called a bribe. Here, the one who is paying it is sinful, and that judge who is taking it is sinful. Also amongst the sins of the hands is to burn an animal, even if it were to be very small in size, like the small red ants, to burn them. Some people have fun burning these animals. You cannot burn them. That is haram. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لا يعذب بالنار إلا ربها. So no one tortures with fire except its Lord. That is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you do not burn them. Also to dismember an animal, even the insects, that is haram. And that is to start chopping off some of its organs. As some people do, they might catch a fly and they start ripping off the wings, the legs and the like while they are alive. That is haram. Also amongst the sins of the hands is to play with the die or anything which contains gambling. That means it relies on guessing and chance. That is forbidden. It's like playing poker, for instance, with the cards and the like. That is classified as a major sin. That's gambling. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called it a wicked act of the devil. Wicked act of the devil. You know, from gambling, because some people become very addicted to gambling, they reach a stage it becomes worse than drugs. They reach a stage that some people sold their own children just to get some money so they can gamble. Some of them lost their houses, their jobs and the like, their properties in gambling. It's very addictive. It's like drugs. And that is haram as well. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called it a wicked act of devils. So in general, betting from both sides and putting money, that is classified as gambling, and that is haram. Like one would say, "I'll put $10 and you put $10. Then we make a draw. Whoever name comes up will take the $20. That's haram. That's a kind of gambling. That's a kind of gambling. Similar to the case these days some people do, and they make like a small community from some members. They come together, let us say 20 people, and they say everyone puts 100. So 20 people will be 2,000. Then they say, we make a draw, and the one whose name comes up will take the 2,000. So people start participating, putting the 100, hoping to get what? The 2,000. So they are giving 100 to get the 2,000. This is a kind of riba, and that is haram. This is a kind of riba, and that is haram. Look at the companions, and to what extent they were very cautious in only consuming what is halal. So if they were to be offered a huge amount of money, but not from halal, they won't take it. And they live dignified, honored. And some of them received the good tidings from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be in paradise. Their hearts were attached to the hereafter, not to the worldly matters. Also amongst the sins of the hands is to play unlawful musical instruments like the lute. The lute is now like the Arabs. They have kind of strings and they use it. They have something like this. Also, there is something called rabab, similar to the violin. The flute, that is forbidden as well, and any string instruments. Piano, for instance, anything that relies on the passing of air when playing them or strumming the strings is classified as a forbidden instrument. The drum, the normal drum, does not cause enchantment. In the past, they used to use a drum, normal drum. All these cymbals as well, they made them from copper. So they do not cause enchantment to the person. But there are instruments like the violin, the piano, and the like. They do cause enchantment. That's why they are forbidden. To intentionally touch the marriageable woman who is other than his mahram and his wife. Mahram like his sister, his mother, his niece, he is allowed to touch her. But other than those ones and the like, and his wife, he is not allowed to touch with or without desire. With or without desire, that's haram. Unless we talked before, like when she goes to a doctor with the conditions that we mentioned before, and there is a need to go to that doctor, then he needs to do an operation and the like. That's a different case. But we're talking about normal situation. Also amongst the sins of the hands, to depict that which has a soul. According to Imam al-Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, Imam Ahmad and Imam Abu Hanifa, these three scholars said, you cannot depict that which has a soul, even if it were to be 2D, like on a paper or on the wall, like a full human being or a full animal, something that has a soul, to depict, to draw it 2D, complete, on the wall or on a paper, that is forbidden according to these three scholars. If it is in a case, the drawing, what if this is alive, it would live. So if, for instance, you draw only a head, it doesn't survive in that case, if it's real. To draw half, that is not a case where it lives, if it's real. So in that case, it's not sinful, the 2D we're talking about. If it's full, according to those three scholars, they said it is forbidden. According to Imam Malik radiallahu anhu, he said it's disliked when it is 2D and full in a way that it can survive if it's real. But to depict like a sculpture, to sculpt a sculpture that's a 3D of an animal or a human being, even if it's not full, that's haram. It was mentioned that one of the companions saw someone making a drawing of what we mentioned, people, animals, and the like. He told him, what are you doing? He said, this is my profession. I work in this. So I draw them and I sell them. He said, you can't do that. He said, so what should I do? He said, draw a tree. Draw a tree. Draw a mountain and the like. But you do not draw people and humans that are full. But as we mentioned, because sometimes at school you might be asked to make some drawings, you can take with the saying of Imam Malik radiallahu anhu, so long as it's 2D, it's not 3D, it's not haram according to Imam Malik radiallahu anhu. Also amongst the sins of the hands is to refrain from paying one's zakah or part of one's zakah. So let us say he has to pay this amount, he doesn't pay in full, he pays half of it. He is sinful. Or he didn't pay it at all, he is sinful. After it is due, and when one is able to pay it. And he is not allowed in this case to delay it for no excuse. Some people, let us say, they start a business trading in Rajab. And they invest a big amount of money. So after 1 year lapses on them, that's Rajab of the following year, they have money that is subject to zakah. They have to pay its due zakah. They cannot say, oh, I'm going to wait till Ramadan and pay its zakah. They are not allowed to do so. In Ramadan, we pay only zakat of badan. They call it zakatul fitr. But your money, its time is not Ramadan. It depends. Let us say you inherited 1 kilogram of gold in Rajab. When do you pay its zakah? Rajab of the following year. So you do not delay till Sha'ban or Ramadan. Also to refuse to give an employee his pay. So he's done the job, then you refuse to pay him the fees and his pay, that is forbidden as well. To refuse to give the starving person what fulfills one's need. So someone, let us say, is about to die of hunger or of thirst, and he asks you for some food so he can survive. If you refuse and you are able to give him, and you refuse, you make him die, that is forbidden. Or he is about to die of thirst, out of thirst, then you need to provide him with water. If you refuse, you are sinful. Even sometimes clothing, if it's in a very cold weather, if he doesn't have some clothes, will die. Then you have to give him what would make him survive. To refrain from saving a drowning person without an excuse in both cases as well. Now, unless you don't know how to swim. So instead of one drowning, we'll end up having two people drowning. That's a different case. But if you know how to swim and you can save that person, then you need to save him. To write what is prohibited to say. Anything you are not allowed to say by your tongue, you are not allowed to write it by your hand. And finally, to betray, which is opposite to sincere advice. And this includes deeds, sayings, and conditions. If someone entrusts you with something, you are not allowed to betray him. Sometimes he might say, keep that with you until I come back from this trouble. You come back from that trouble and he denies that you kept something with him. So he betrayed you. That is haram. To betray in words. Someone comes to you and asks you about someone who proposed to his daughter. He wants to marry his daughter. And you know that this person is junkie, as you say, or take drugs. So you tell him, look, this person, you start by warning him without going into details if he understands. So he might say, I don't advise you, don't do it. If he insists to know, you might mention. That's the advice that you need to give to him. So you don't say, because I don't want to talk anything bad about him. So you start praising him, tell him, oh, he's wonderful. And you start saying he's a good person, and he's never been in the mosque. He doesn't pray, he takes drugs, whatever. So here you betrayed him. He asked you for a sincere advice, and you betrayed him. That is haram. Also in condition, some people pretend to be entrusted so people can believe them and entrust them with matters and the like. But they deceive people. That is classified as betraying as well. And that is forbidden. We ask Allah to keep us steadfast on Islam and make us die as righteous Muslims. Ameen. And Allah knows best. We say La ilaha illallah and make salah on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.